Thank you all for coming. This is quite a great night. I am Cindy Lott. I am the Interim Academic Program Director for Nonprofit Management Programs at the School of Professional Studies. This, of course, this evening is put on by the Fundraising Management Program. We're in a transition at the school, moving fundraising management into nonprofit management. It's anticipated. And so tonight is a really great event. As you all know, I'm thrilled that you all are here. I'm going to be turning this directly over to the faculty who are totally responsible for this evening and for this class. As I mentioned, we have luminaries about in our community, and we are so glad to have them come to the school and actually speak to the rest of our community. And all of you are, in fact, part of our community. We have students, we have alumni, we have prospective students, we have professors, we have experts from the community. All of you are part of this community, and we want to make sure that you come back. Without further ado, I'm going to do the actual quick thank you and introduction of the faculty who are then going to introduce your speaker tonight and beyond. So Marcia Stepanek is a journalist, digital and visual media expert, as you know. She teaches this class, the Wired Nonprofit. She taught it at this other school down the way before she came up here. We've had her since 2014. Many of you know Marcia, of course. She's a former Knight Fellow at Stanford. She writes for the Social Innovation Review there. She was a Pulitzer finalist. I have had the pleasure of just now starting to get to know Marcia. It's been phenomenal, all that I am learning that she is doing. And she co-teaches this class, as most of you know, with Howard Greenstein, who is marketing technology strategist, president of the Harbor Group, COO of Domainscape, an IP startup. And so his specialty is working at the intersection of marketing and technology. And also her other co-teacher is Tom Watson, who's the president and founder of CauseWired. And many of you may know that the book by the same name. He's also journalist, author, and the specialist at the intersection of media, technology, and social change. You can find their full bios, and I do direct you to the SPS website for fundraising management. It's still under that, and you can find out much, much more about this program if you're interested. So I, again, welcome you all, and I want to thank also not only Marcia, Tom, and Howard, but also the staff that put this event together. This was, as Marcia will explain, the first of what we hope is a series, and they already had this scheduled, and we decided to make it open to the community, and that's exactly what we're hoping to do for the benefit of the students and the Columbia and the New York community. So thanks again. It's going to be a great evening.
Thank you, Cindy. And it was wonderful how this all kind of came together over a lunch and conversation with Howard and Tom and myself and Cindy. We really appreciate her energy and her vision for these kind of programs. It's really delightful. And we're the first faculty, but I know my colleagues in the faculty will always get their chance as well. What's really delightful tonight is to see some former students from NYU, from Columbia, some faculty colleagues, some of our dear friends from the nonprofit sector who are out there leading the way, and of course our future leaders we're so proud of. I want to thank the Fundraising Student Association too for their incredible support and energy here, and we thank everybody for being so involved and interested in this, and welcome. We started this class, a few things just about the Wired Nonprofit to start out with. We designed this because technology, as we all know, it's not just dumb tools, right? It's also changing the way we behave. It's changing our relationships with each other. It's changing our relationships with our organizations. And it's really starting to create a new kind of power. Citizen media aside, these tools are also creating and catalyzing incredible changes within our nonprofit organizations and creating new demands for new kinds of leadership as a result of that. And there's no one better than Sree Sreenivasan, who embodies that kind of new leadership. Everybody's got a Sree story. And my Sree story is I was a founding editor-in-chief of Contribute Magazine, and I had asked him, the magazine that covered kind of the changes, the digital changes, the rise of online activism. And I invited Sree to a round table. And even then, like way before Snapchat, way before Twitter, way before any of these other platforms, Sree was like leading the way with all of this stuff. And just down the hall, he would hold these incredible social media weekends. And he would pack the room, and he would command an audience of people from all over the country, media people, educators, leaders of nonprofits, and he would inspire us all by his enthusiasm, his incredible example, and his passion for experimenting with new tools and creating the kinds of communities that we all envy as nonprofit leaders, and teaching us how to do it. And Sree is one of those people who, you know, has a couple thousand of his closest friends, right? But in his case, it's pretty real. He's quite a force, and we're so honored and delighted to have him here tonight. One thing I do want to say is my incredible co-professors, Howard and Tom, have really helped to keep this class evolving and keeping pace with all of the change. And we're just having a great time, and we're very honored to be part of the program here at Columbia. So thank you so much for having us. Two things is just a little run of the show tonight. We'll have Sree. I want Doug White to come up and say a few words. He has been here too with students. He also had been at NYU. He has a few things to say. Then we're going to have Sree come up and show some of his magic and talk about how these tools are changing the way our institutions are run today. And as an observer of 20 years of this stuff, he can also talk a little bit about where all this stuff is going and what we can learn from that. And then we will have a Q&A with the audience with Sree. And then we're going to start our little shorter version tonight of the Wired Nonprofit. And we're going to talk a little bit about data, big data, and what it means to be data informed. And hopefully we will not put you to sleep on that. It's pretty exciting stuff when you get into it. So without further ado, Doug, please come up, and then we'll have Sree.
I'm going to be up long because everything that can be said that's, about this program is so great. I just am reminded of when this was born, and it was born at New York University. And Marcia came with this idea that was incredible, and her colleagues put this thing together. And I can't tell you how fortunate we are to have this program here at Columbia University. You people who are not now students will make friends with other students today and learn how fabulous they are. When we ask for applications, we ask for basically two things in addition to their academic prowess. One is their ability to communicate, and the other, and most important, is their passion for making the world a better place. And that's what I see in all of my classes and with all of the students, and I think it's just wonderful. I couldn't be more honored or humbled to be a part of this program. And so all of my students and all of the people here, I'm thankful that you have had me. And as I say, without further ado, we have one of the most exceptional evenings you'll ever see in your life. Sree, come on up.
Oh, my God.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. That was wonderful, but also very unfair, because now you've been promised one of the most exceptional evenings of your life. That's really hard to deliver on. I like to live by the George W. Bush campaign motto, low expectations, right? You remember this? The low expectations, you can get very far. So we're going to have some fun, I hope, learn a lot, and share information, and we're doing that in multiple ways. There's the conversation that I'm leading here, but we also have multiple conversations online. And there is the Periscope conversation that's happening right now, and I'm going to show you where you can find it. If you go onto onto Twitter, you will see on the Sree Nonprofits, under Sree Nonprofits, you'll see there's lots of conversations, and if you follow the, one second, here we go. If you follow Columbia_SPS, everyone should do that, follow Columbia_SPS. And if you do that, you will see the live video that's happening right now. And you can watch from your
SPS. Everyone should do that. Columbia_SPS.
Shouldn't do that. Okay, I'm going to turn that off. But so you know that's live on the internet. So what I'm going to do here is retweet this, and I'm going to say, "Watch us," right? So watch us live now, okay? And this will then get seen and be available publicly for everybody. So I'm just going to hit this now. So I'd love for you to go in there and hit retweet. So it's under Columbia_SPS. The other way that the conversation's happening is on Facebook. So if you go to facebook.com/SreeNet, that's on my personal Facebook, we have now 70 other people watching live on Facebook right now because my friend Christiana, if you'd wave from there, is right now holding up my phone and broadcasting live to the world. And one new thing that has happened in Facebook, even with, there's always new things happening, but this particular feature I think is very exciting. You see this live subscribe? So if you hit that, anytime that I am live anywhere in the world, you will get an alert on Facebook. That sounds really scary, so you may not want to do that. But it's a way to make sure that you don't miss what I do. They're not very exciting. Mostly what I've been using Facebook Live video for is reading the New York Times Sunday edition out to the public, which is really weird. But we have about 1,000 people who join us on the weekends and just kind of have fun with it. So if you just join me on Facebook, you can find it. And right now you can go in here and people are commenting and sharing and all of that. So you can see stuff here. Somebody from India is watching right now, and Bridget's watching from East Northport, Roland's watching from New York, etc. And so we have a nice little community there. So these are two different ways you can participate. And sort of the point to make about this is that this tells you how much the world has changed. When you look at what's new in the world of digital media, to me, the fact that you can now broadcast to the world instantly, immediately, is a big changer for nonprofits. And we will talk about other ideas, of course, about nonprofits, but I just wanted to focus on this for a minute, and I urge you all to learn how this technology works. We've had the ability for people to be broadcasting for years. But what Periscope has done has made it really easy. And what Facebook has done is make it possible for your built-in community to see it instantly. And this changes a lot in terms of how nonprofits are going to communicate, good and bad, because you're going to see that you're not able to control the story as much because people are going to come to your events and they're going to start broadcasting. For years, we in the nonprofit world and in businesses were trying to understand how do people deal with photography in our lives. At the museums in particular, we were worried about photography. Now photography is very common. But what happens when people start shooting video? When I see someone with a camera now, I presume they're taking a photograph or they're taking a video. And normally, I don't mind because that video is just going to be stuck on their camera and will never see the light of day. But starting with Facebook Live being available, Periscope being available, you're being broadcast into the world. And that's a different relationship with that camera on both sides of it. So we need to be thinking about it. So one of the things I'm always telling people in my classes is to think about using social, using this digital. Get to practice as much as you can, and practice on me when you need to, but practice so that you're ready when you need to do something for work or for anything else. All of us will have at some point some world exclusive happen in front of us. It will happen. And will you be able to tell that story to the world instantly, or will it just disappear? And you can't wait till you can't wait till that thing happens for you to practice, right? You have to practice in advance. So please practice as much as you can as we all get better at social. We're all learning all the time. And I want to again thank SPS and my friends at the program and this particular class for bringing me here and giving me a chance to come back home to Columbia Journalism School and the great World Room. This is where the Pulitzer Prizes are announced in a few weeks there, where they were judged and where they'll be announced. And it's a magical room. So, and one thing, if you learn nothing else today, learn the pronunciation of Joseph Pulitzer's name. It's Pulitzer, like, sir, can you pull it? Though that's not something you want to be saying to a lot of sirs walking around, but it's Pulitzer, not Pulitzer, which is what many people say. We're talking about the nonprofit world, right? And I thought I'd start by just showing you this image header on my Facebook page, on my Facebook profile. And this is a photograph you see of a handsomer than we've come to expect Abraham Lincoln. And this is the very first photograph that was on a campaign button ever done. And this was obviously in the 1860 campaign. And online you have seen that there are a lot of things attributed to Lincoln, Einstein, and Gandhi that they never said. And one of my favorite internet meme things is a photograph of Einstein saying, I didn't say half the shit they say I said on the internet, right? Like I love that idea. But this, as far as I'm able to tell, is an actual quote from Abraham Lincoln. And the fact that you're all here, you're on the nonprofit world, you want to make the better place, I salute you, and look what he said. And in the end, it's not the years in your life that counts, it's the life in your years. It's not the years in your life that counts, it's the life in your years, right? Not the years in your life, but the life in your years. And each one of you, by being so interested in nonprofits, that's why you're here, and that's why it's so exciting to work with the nonprofit world. I spent 21 years at Columbia in this building, and now I'm at the Metropolitan Museum, and that's another place where it's nonprofit and where we have a mission to make the world a better place. And at Columbia, we do it through education. At the museum, we do it to art and culture. And each of you might be in a different field, but what we're going to talk about today, I think, will help you no matter what kind of nonprofit work you're doing. And I want to acknowledge that there are real experts in the world of digital as well as nonprofits in the room. I'm not going to call them out and embarrass them because that's not fair. But one friend of mine just walked in, and I haven't seen her in a long time. I'm just going to point her out. Her name is Poonam Prasad. She's in the back there. If you just wave, Poonam is one of the world's experts on nonprofits and nonprofit boards and fundraising and everything else. She's a professor of fundraising and philanthropy, and we're really lucky she's in the room with us because she's so great. And thank you for coming, and thank you all for coming on a cold, cold day here in New York. So let's get started and think about what we're trying to do today. We have about half an hour, 45 minutes, and then we'll have some Q&A. And what we want to do is to leave you with some lessons that I've learned from doing social media, digital media at Columbia. I see one of my Met colleagues is here as well. So doing it at Columbia and at the Met. And if it isn't clear, this photograph, I should say before I go away, is from the Met's extensive collection of photographs. And that, again, is a photograph of Lincoln. He didn't have a beard at the time, and some little girl wrote to him saying, you must grow a beard, and he did. And that's how he grew that beard of his. Okay, so here's something interesting that happened to me today on my way here at 6:12 p.m., so it's 7 o'clock. Jigar Mehta is a rock star in the world of journalism, and you should all follow him. He's at Jigar Mehta. And Jigar was announced today as the new head of social video and at Fusion, because Fusion is trying to really ramp up what they're doing. So he's the VP of digital operations at Fusion. And this unusual thing happened. There was an article about him, And it started with my LinkedIn recommendation of him, was what they called him out on. And it's got this kind of weird way of saying it, right? Like, I've had my eye on him for a long time. I guess I said something like that in the LinkedIn. I got to now go back and check. What it does tell you is that almost anything you say online will live on forever. And that's the lead. I never expected my LinkedIn recommendation to be the lead in a story about a wonderful journalist. But today is about connecting and sharing information. And so I thought that was quite amusing that was there. I have some slides that I'm going to use just as kind of backdrop for our conversation. And the slides are to help us and help you kind of follow up and check on things. But you really don't need the slides. What you want to do is to take some notes, either on a piece of paper or on a computer, and have two columns. Really make a checklist, an action checklist, and have two columns. One column should say, try now. The next column should say, try later. And then the third column could say, what a waste of time this guy is. I can't believe they brought him here. And then write things in that. Right? So you should have three columns from tonight. The hashtag we're using, by the way, is #SreeNonprofits. Sree Nonprofits. One of the lessons about having a hashtag is once you make one, once you settle on it, you have to be semi-obnoxious about it. Semi is a key word, but obnoxious. What I mean is you have to tell everybody what the hashtag is. And I didn't focus on this issue, so I didn't have the hashtag enough early enough that it wasn't on the invitation. But if you're a nonprofit and you're making an event, a conference, a project, you're launching anything, have a hashtag and be semi-obnoxious about it. Get it out to people. So even now, I screwed up by not telling it to you multiple times before we started. So use #SreeNonprofits. If enough of you are tweeting with that hashtag, we can trend here in New York tonight. This is enough people. We've done sessions where we've trended with many fewer people than this. So I'm leaving it up to you to get this seen by the world. So retweet your stuff. The slides can be found at this link, bit.ly/2YRS. And I think about these as kind of lessons from 2 years at the 2.5 years at the Met. You have my Twitter contacts, my Instagram @SreeNet, LinkedIn, etc. But I did want to focus your attention on two things. One is a series of tweets. I've been doing a tweet storm of 126 tweets using the hashtag LearnSocialMedia. And if you can find that on Twitter, you have everything I know on social media and 126 tweets. So you can leave right now and not learn anything else new from me by going to #LearnSocialMedia. And you can see what they are. So I'm going to just show you a few of them just to get started. What's common sense in real life is common sense on social media. You don't have to share every thought that pops into your head. When the great David Carr died, I tweeted about him, and he used to look at his own tweets through the eyes of his bosses. Think about that. What a wonderful idea. That everything I write, I'm going to look at it through the eyes of my boss before I send it out. It's very, very important to think about that. Use a recognizable recent headshot for your profile photo. Such easy, simple advice. Doesn't have to be by a pro, but it helps. It's not who follows you that matters. It's who follows you that matters. Who are the influencers who are looking at your content? And number 6, everyone wants more followers, but what about followees? Who are you listening to? We're always looking for great people to follow, and I already gave you one, Jigar Mehta and others, so always look for who should you be following, who can you learn from. And I also have a closed Facebook group for people who have taken my classes and friends and experts. If you just go onto Facebook and search Sree's Advanced, all right, just go to Sree's Advanced, you'll find about 1,800 people from around the world who are sharing ideas, comments, posting questions, answering them, and you'll learn a lot by joining. So just ask to join that, and I'll approve you, and then you'll be part of this community. The whole point is, folks, and with nonprofits, we're building communities and building a community and multiple communities when we don't need them, so that they're there when we need them. Often in the business world, as well as nonprofits, you only hear from the organization when they are asking for money, or they want you to come buy a ticket for something. They're selling you something, and that's important. But the way to get people to love what you're doing is to make sure you build a community where you're not selling all the time. Even if it's the most worthy thing in the world, you can't be just selling it all the time. And many of you know this already, Social Media Weekend this year is June 10th and 11th, and people from all over the world are going to be joining us. You can find that online. The hashtag is SMWKND, and we hope you'll come and we'll be down at City University Journalism School, so please join us there if you can. So whenever I teach, I always say, always be charging your phone. Very important, right? Always be charging your phone. How many of you are charging your phone right now? Somehow, look around you, a few of you are, right? You have an extra battery of some kind. Christiana has an extra battery pack. Look at that. That looks like a kind of monstrous you can kill somebody with that. It's also a good way to make friends at airports because you have extra battery life. But hold up your battery charges. Be proud. There you go. And Mophie case, a vote for the Mophie case. He has three. My friend Stefan there has three Mophie cases. Three Mophie cases. So M-O-P-H-I-E. Number two, always be connecting. And what that means is connect with people when you don't need them so that they're there when you need them. We talked about that a little bit, that of building your community. But what I mean by that is you don't need Jigger for anything right now, but here he is. I just told you he's one of the world's great experts on social journalism, social video. Why don't you follow him now? Or talk to them. Talk to anybody I talk about. Just tweet at them and just say, hey, at Jigar Mehta, we're talking about you, #3nonprofits. Connect. Practice by working, connecting with people when you don't need them so that they're there when you need them. And finally, always be collecting is very simple. Use your phone as a collection device. Always be shooting pictures of things you think that are important. You have the slides from the presentation, but the slides are like, you know, 40, 50 slides. You'll never look at them again. But if you have 5 images out of tonight that you find useful, when you're sitting at the doctor's office and elsewhere, you'll look at them. So always be connecting, always be charging, and always be collecting. Now, according to Twitter Counter, I'm the 84,000th most important person in the world of Twitter. Right? So this tells you how hard-pressed our organizers were here tonight, that they couldn't find the 83,000th most important person, so they got me. And what does this tell you? A couple of things, that you have to really think about kind of what these numbers and metrics mean. There are so many things about metrics, but just raw numbers don't tell you anything. And I'm going to show you how you can find the most influential and important people in your Twitter networks and how you can continue to work and connect with them. And finally, if you ever are on some kind of list, don't worry about it when this happens. You know, some people look at their clout scores and get upset, and there's no reason to get upset. And this is an example of that. When I talk about the museum and the world that I live in now, I always start by showing this particular photograph of the Met. If you haven't seen the outside of the Met in a terrible mess, that means you haven't been to the Met in about 5 years, because we've only recently redone our beautiful plaza, and I hope you'll all come see it. And I love showing this picture because it was taken from across the street by one of our 15 full-time photographers at the Met, Eileen Travell. And she's at Eileen Travell on Instagram, so if you want to follow her and say hi to her, at Eileen Travell, T-R-A-V-E-L-L. And she shot this with her iPhone 5. And it's a beautiful picture. It's even better, you know, not on the projector. And what that says to me is something really important in the world of digital for nonprofits. Tells me that expertise matters. Expertise matters. Why? when I was here at Columbia, people would often say to me, and I was dean of students, so we're doing admissions, career services, all of that. People would say to me, Sree, how can you charge Ivy League prices for an industry that's dying? And I'd say, the industry of journalism is not dying. There's more journalism being created and consumed than ever before. It's the business model that's kind of wonky at the moment. But in a world where everyone's a writer, the trained writer stands taller. In a world where everyone's a photographer, the trained photographer stands taller. If I had taken this picture, it would have looked awful. But when she takes it, it looks beautiful, right? And that's why all of you, as you're navigating the world of digital as a nonprofit executive or staffer, or you want to build your own nonprofit, you have to understand that what's going to really help you succeed is not all these digital tools. It's your experience, your background, your expertise, your Rolodex. I said Rolodex the other day to a younger person who had no idea what I was talking about. And I said it was an actual thing we had on our desks that rolled, and that's how you had contacts. So it's like, I said it's sort of like Apple contacts, right? That's what that are, Google contacts. So expertise matters. Never forget that as you're trying to navigate the digital world, that expertise is what's going to really help you survive and thrive. Here's an evening version of the Met as well. At the Met, we think of four spaces for our work. We have the Met, the main building on Fifth Avenue. It's called Met Fifth Avenue. On the right is, upper right is the Met Cloisters, which is the beautiful medieval gardens and museum in Upper Manhattan. The other day, someone posted on Instagram, I love going there. It reminds me of Game of Thrones. And then on the lower left is our brand new location, the Met Broyer, where the Whitney used to be. I hope you've all been down to the new Whitney Museum. It's a native 21st century museum. We're a native 19th century museum at the Met. So this is their old space. We're taking over. It's opening March 18th. Members get in early. And we're launching our website and all of that next week as part of the launch of that. But our director, Tom Campbell, has told us there's a fourth location, and the fourth location is the Digital Met. And I urge you all to think about your nonprofits in the same idea. How do we connect the digital and the physical, the in-person and the online? Many of you work for nonprofits that do incredible work overseas. And how do you get that connection with what's happening on the ground, say in India, and get people in America to care, right? That's one of the things that you have to do. There's so many other things, but that's one of the things you have to do. So one of the big ideas from Tom is to say that all four spaces are of equal value, and that visitors, whether digital or in person, are of equal value. That's a big, big leap for a museum, and we're very excited about the opportunities that come from that. We were recently named one of the top 25 museums in the world by TripAdvisor, and it's an unusual thing and kind of awkward because what's the difference between number one, number two, number three, and it's a subjective list. But there's a very important lesson for all of us in here, that we all think that the thing that matters are the big famous brands, the press matters more than anything else. But people are making their decisions about what to do in the cities they visit from TripAdvisor, Yelp, things like that. So how are you making sure that your great reviews, the things that you want people to know, are happening in the crowdsourced space as well as everywhere else? By the way, the Met is as big as the Empire State Building is tall, and this is a way to think about that. One of the things that I've been thinking about is millennials, and how do we engage them more at the Met? How do you engage them in your work? And there's a great essay written by Damon Kiesau. He's at D. Kiesau. You could just say, hey, Damon, we're watching you. We're talking about you. And he says that while much of the journalism being produced by legacy news organizations is of value to younger readers, it does not entirely speak their language nor fully reflect their lives. And you can substitute nonprofit for the word journalism, and it's the same situation, right? That the work you're doing as a legacy organization, it is of interest to younger people, but it doesn't, you don't speak their language, nor do you reflect their lives. How do you make that connection? That's something that I'd love for you to think about. And we want to think about the tools we can use to tell these stories. I was asked, what are the big trends? And this was last year, and I said, it feels like it's 2006 all over again. Podcasting, email newsletters, blogging are all hot. Why are they hot? They're hot because the technology to produce them and the technology to absorb them are digest them are and consume them are easier than ever before. We just talked about what you can do with Periscope, what you can do with Facebook Live Video. You can think about podcasting. There's a tool I recommend to every institution that is selling a business, I'm sorry, selling a service, product, or idea, and nonprofits have some combination of all three. There's a service I recommend called Blog Talk Radio, which I have used to do more than 200 shows for the South Asian Journalists Association, for Columbia Journalism School. We've had more than 2-3 million listens to that, and it's such easy phone-based technology. You just want to write it down and check it out and see if it makes sense for you. Email newsletters. We brought in the women from The Skim to talk to us about how to get better at email newsletters. Anyone here reading The Skim? Raise your hand. Everybody should subscribe to The Skim. I am not a millennial woman, but it's aimed at millennial women, and I read it every day. And what they're really good at is, how do you make people want to open your letters, their newsletters? And you should be thinking about, what are good newsletter recommendations? Maybe in the Facebook comments, you want to post some really good newsletters that people should be reading. If you have some, put them in there. And then blogging's also become so much easier to do, of course. And here's another idea from the museum that I think applies to all of you. I was asked, what is our biggest competition? And I said, our competition is not another museum. Our competition is Netflix, Candy Crush, life in the year 2015, 2016. And what does that mean for all of you? When I talk to people in nonprofits, often they're so frustrated because they say, I'm doing such good work. This is such a great project. Such a great project. Yes, it is, but that doesn't mean that people should care or will care. And the only thing that's going to help is your ability to use these tools to get attention to those things. If you Google TEDx Broadway and my name, you'll see I did a TEDx talk about attention and how do we get attention to things. One of the things that I talk about in that is that at NASA, the head of NASA is an African-American gentleman, and most of you did not know that. And I met some folks who work at NASA who had no idea, and they were African-American, that the head of NASA is himself African-American. I told them, and they were so excited about that, right? So you can be in that environment and not know interesting things, right? When you produce something really worthy, you put it out there, you hope everybody sees it. The answer is almost no one's seen it. And how do you get attention to that? So no matter how worthy the cause, we have to fight for attention. And there's no use saying, this is so great, everybody will see it. You have to work to activate whatever great thing it is you're doing. So as we think about social media and digital, we think about, you know, how you can use it to get new trends, ideas, and sources for information, how to connect with audiences in new and deeper ways, how to bring eyeballs, traffic, and attention to your work, and how to create, enhance your brand, how to connect with fundraising, how to get fundraising, how to get more funds for what you want to do. And there are so many tools out there. I just want to mention a few of them here that you want to be checking out. There's a tool called Canva. Anybody here using that for building images for social media? Like, one of my principles about social media is, whenever you're posting something on social, make an image or video or something to go with it. The reason is that people are on their phones all day going like this, right? And you need to create what I call thumb stoppers. Every single item should have a thumb stopper. So I go like this, pause, go like this, pause, right? So what kind of thumb stoppers have you put in with your content? So Canva allows you to make beautiful images really fast. There are some others on there as well. And another product I want to talk about is called Muckrack, which shows you who has shared your link. So if you go to whosharedmylink.com and you put in a URL, it'll show you which journalists and bloggers have shared your link or how many influencers have shared your link. And so that's another way to kind of think about this idea. So I'm going to switch here to just come in here 1 second. And we're, I don't know if we're trending yet. Anybody checking if we're trending? Check in New York and see. If you're, oh, there we are. Look at that. So, by the way, why am I showing you this? Because some consultant out there is going to sell you, I will get you to trend. It's so difficult. It's so magical. Look at this, right? Not everybody here is even tweeting. But if you have good content, people will follow you, right? And people are following us here. Why are we number five, guys? Come on, let's get up there. Tweet more, share more. There's Cause Global. Marsha's tweeting right now, right? And others are tweeting. You can see that. There's going to pop up here. There's Emma, Manhattan underscore mama. There she's. Emma, wave from there. You can say hi to her. So practice, post. If you're really shy and don't want to post tonight, doesn't matter. Just post something. If you're not posting on Twitter, fine. Post on Instagram. Is Celeste here? I see Celeste Ford. There she is. Hey, Celeste. Oh, yeah, you're both here. Great. And the New York Times fridge liked us. You know, this is one of those stealth accounts. So we're posting. And this is part, remember I started by saying being semi-obnoxious, right? Like telling people to do something. Even when you want to give people something free, they don't necessarily want it. I promise you that even after telling 100 people in this room, plus hundreds of people online, very few people will bother to go onto Facebook and join the community. It's just like that, because they're like, why should I do that? Or they'll forget, or they're playing Candy Crush, right? So that's just the way things are, that if someone can take a screenshot and tweet this, that would be nice, so that we have this here. Hey, we moved up one spot. Look, just being obnoxious can result, semi-obnoxious can result in that. We don't want to be higher than black women in Hollywood, and but we can be. I don't even know what some of these other things are. No, look, SAK photos, SAK Cap, S Kaplan photos. Sorry, S Kaplan photos. Follow him, Stefan. That is, yeah, his name is Stefan, but his handle is S Kaplan photos. He was the photo editor and social media guru, so follow him as well. So I'm just going to show you here how it works with a tool called Twiangulate. Anyone here using Twiangulate? Anyone? Okay. So we're going to go on Twiangulate. You hit reach of. This is going to take a minute. All right. Here we go. So Twiangulate does a couple of different things, but I'm going to focus on one thing here, and I'm going to type in at UN, okay, and hit retrieve. What this is going to show you is who your 100 most influential followers are. Very useful tool for all of you. So at UN has 6 million followers, but their top 100 followers have 430 million followers. Everybody see that? Their 100 top followers have 430 million followers. That means that their 6 million users are great, followers are great, but the 100 are the ones that really matter. And you've got to be thinking about how you cultivate and grow those 100 followers. And so, for example, here's Bill Gates, and you can guess who those folks are, right? I do the same thing on my list. I type in there and go and see who my 100 are. And I look and think about them, and I'll just show you. So I go in here like this, and I hit, by the way, my face is here in the photograph because I said something nice about them, and I don't have a logo, so they put that there. So here, so my top 100 have 142 million followers, right? So while all 70,000 are important, these 100 are really important. And by the way, one of the things that Poonam taught me about dealing with the nonprofit world, she said, you say thank you 7 times to your donors, right? And that's the equivalent here. These are your most influential supporters. What are you doing for? So every time I tweet, I think of, for example, Shashi Tharoor, Barkha Dutt, who's a Columbia J School grad in India. Every time I tweet, I think of Nick Kristoff, Ann Curry. So someone tweeted, Sree thinks of Ann Curry every time he tweets. Like, you know, that's not exactly what I meant, but you understand, right? Like, what I'm really saying in every one of my tweets is, Ann Curry, please don't unfollow me. That's the subtext of what I'm saying. Or Nick Kristoff, please don't unfollow me. What is the point of having these people follow you? What is the advantage you have apart from reaching them in a general sort of way? Anybody? You can direct message them, which is a big idea, right? Even if they don't see their emails and anything else, there's a good chance they're going to see their Twitter direct messages. And so that's why that's important. And I spend 3 to 5 minutes through to 6 minutes on every tweet I write. It's because I don't have a real life, but it's also because it's that important. That particular post is that important, and I think about it before I post. So by the way, if you see anybody you know here, just tweet at them and say, hey, at Gary V, we're talking about you in this class. Take a photo. Or, hey, Mr. Rushdie, we're talking about you here. Or there's a Met Museum, et cetera, right? So you can practice that connecting and looking for content that's interesting as you're doing this. Oops, sorry. When I was younger, I wanted to be a millionaire. I just didn't know it would be in unread Gmail messages, as you can see here. And someone said, is this really your Gmail folder? And I said, yes, it is. But you know what's more tragic is that second number, not the million unread email messages, but the 1,200 I started to send and then that are still in draft format. Imagine how different my life would be if I had sent those messages. It would have been much more meaningful. So there's a lot you can see here and go in and look. One of the principles that we've undertaken at the Met is that in our digital media team and the museum itself is that we're like a publishing house, like a media organization. We're creating content. And we're doing, as you can see, 500 blog posts, 1,000 Facebook posts, 3,800 tweets a year. This is what we do in a year, 100 videos. Now, you look at some of this and say, well, it's the Met, so of course you can do all that. That's what I say when I look at the UN and say, oh, that's the UN, they can do that, right? It's all relative. The ideas that come from this conversation are about what makes sense for me. What can I do? I can't do a 500 blog post. Can I do 50? Can I do 20? What can I do to get my content into the stream of the conversations that are out there? And we send out millions and millions of emails as well. I just want to show you before we wrap up here for questions, just show you a couple of examples of us trying to think differently about our content. We have our audio guide, which we love, and our foreign visitors love our audio guide, but a lot of New Yorkers don't like audio guides because it says tourist, right? You're walking around with that. So what you really want is you're standing in front of an item at the Met and you're wondering what this is. You've been there so many times and you're just wondering, I wonder what that is. Now on your smartphone, you can just call up the number and listen and you can educate your visiting friend. We still want you to rent the guide if you need it, but you can also listen in this way. And so that we think is a kind of big idea. It's not original to us, but how do we get our content into ways in which people want them? That's the other thing we've learned is that you may have great content, but people may not like the format that you're offering it up in. So that's something we think about. We have an app, which everybody does, but I just want to recommend, again, as a nonprofit, thinking about some for-profit companies to think about how they do apps. I love the app on the extreme right. It's the NYT Now app. Has anyone seen that? I recommend it to everybody at NYT Now if you want to give them a shout out. And the guy who runs it is Clifford Levy, and if you want to shout out to him, at Clifford Levy. Why I like it, it's only 30% of the New York Times, but it's the right 30% of the New York Times. Next to it is TripIt. It's an app that helps you not plan your travel, but organize your travel once the bookings are made. Move's an app that tracks your steps. And then Dark Sky is an app that is a $3 weather app. And you'll say, that's ridiculous. There's so much weather everywhere available online, and Al Roker's on TV 24/7. Why do I need this? It's $3, but it does one thing really well. It tells you if it's snowing or raining where you're standing in the next hour. That's a brilliant idea, and it works. It's never failed me, and we use it with my kids and my dog and everything else to kind of plan when and where we do stuff. So what's the lesson for us as nonprofits? Let's look at these ideas. Let's make our products useful, simple, delightful. How often have you sat in a meeting where none of these ideas come up? How can we make it as complicated as possible? How can we cram everything into it? Like, let's think about principles like this in what you're doing. We have a media lab where another example of a fun thing we've done, I don't know if you folks have seen this, it's called Meow Met. And it's a Google Chrome extension. You install it in your browser. Once you Google it, you install it in your browser, and every time you open a new tab, a new cat from the Met pops up. What's that about? Well, why I think it's so good that we do this is that you'll see nowhere does it say come to the Met, nowhere does it say buy a ticket, see this video. It's very subtle. There's some branding, but it's very, very relaxed. And because we can't keep asking people to come to the Met, right? We want to best be in people's lives when we're not asking for anything. And that's what you should be doing also. Look at your communication strategy and see what are the things that make sense for you to evolve so that there's more than just kind of you're selling yourself all the time. There's a formula that some people use online. I've seen it from various sources, but one is called 411. Out of every 6 posts, 4 are about other people and other kind of subjects or your topic, but not from your point of view. 1 is a fully packaged, carefully planned item about you, and 1 is something more personal, something with a little more personality. So you can think of that as a formulation. On our website, by the way, we're relaunching the website on Monday. The way we decided what to keep and not keep was based on analytics. And analytics are so important in what we're doing. And we hired a great expert on arts analytics named Elena Villa-Espesa. And I'm just going to show you her handle so you can say hi to her. Elenustica. Oops, sorry. Here she is. So follow her. And she runs a really nice blog on arts metrics that you'll learn a lot from following. She was at the Tate and then came to the Met. She just became a PhD. So do check this out, Art Metrics, or follow Elena and tell her you heard about her in the session. And the idea for us as we're creating all this content is to say, when and where does it make sense for us to connect with the world, and when can we do that? So the last thing before we go to Q&A is to just give you a sense of our social media specifically. And we doubled our social media team to 2 people in the last couple of years. And you can see their names right there. Does everybody see that? That's at Taylor C. Newby and at Museum Mammy. There are 5 M's in Museum Mammy. And that's Kim Drew is her name. And follow them and say hi. And now you have friends who run one of the most interesting accounts in the world. And we put their names in our Twitter bio. Why did we do that? So that people who may feel intimidated about communicating with the Met would be comfortable communicating with them. Make your social media more personality-driven when it makes sense, and more human by showing the humans behind it as often and as reasonably as possible. You can do that. So you can see some of the things we're doing on here, and number of posts and things like that. We have multiple Instagram channels, but we only have 1 Twitter channel. And the reason we only have 1 Twitter account is that I think there's much more power in having kind of 1 water cannon of an account than a lot of water pistols is what you'll have if you have a bunch of smaller Twitter accounts. We're also on Weibo, which is a big Chinese network. And here you're seeing that we are the 7th most followed museum in the world on Twitter, but we are the number 1 account based on a study someone else did on influence. And I would much rather be influential than have a lot of followers. You can buy followers very easily. After we do the Q&A, I'll give you my social media success formula. But you, what you want to think about is, how do I stay successful by being influential? So that's interesting, but I want you to look at this person here, Mar Dixon, at Mar Dixon, lives in Shropshire, England, and she is more influential than all these other museums. Oops, sorry. Very scary. What am I doing here? Oh, sorry. Sorry, folks. Here. So how is she more influential than all these museums? By being at the center of the conversation. Are you the center of your subject's conversation for your nonprofit? Or are you just having your own little conversation by yourself over here? Or are you in the conversation with a lot of other people and they keep referring to you? So we're the blue in the middle of the world of museums. She's one of the other nodes there as well. I circulated to all of you an article via email, for those of you in person, and I'll tweet this later using the hashtag nonprofits, an article by Beth Cantor, and I hope you'll all follow at Beth Cantor, who's an expert on nonprofits, and she did a post about our boss, Tom Campbell, on Instagram. Very thoughtful, she went in and looked at how he's using it, and I think this is an example, and I'm very proud of what my colleague is doing and my boss is doing on Instagram. And people ask me, how come he's on Instagram and not on Twitter? Because there's less drama on Instagram. And this is something that people think it's because it's a museum, that's why it's there. That's a factor, but not the main factor. He is using this as a way of connecting with the world, connecting with supporters, visitors, even employees. You can see which employees are now replying to him on his own Instagram. He was named one of the 23 best art Instagrams in the world. And that's while he was still on his 4S. He now has a 6, so watch out, world. So I encourage you to take a look at him. So let's pause here, and let's take some questions.
Thank you, Sree.
Here's Tom.
Great as always.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, that was fantastic. As you know, this is...
We're number 2 now.
Number 2. Keep on tweeting. Tweet all these questions. We have about 20 minutes for questions. But as you know, this is a class. And so I'd like to give the place of honor to the first question to one of our students in our class. And so Melita has a question.
Thank you so much for all that helpful information. I'm just wondering, for small organizations that don't have the access to such a catalog of images, what would you say the top 3 suggestions are that you have for starting to build community?
I think this is something that all of us ask when we see other organizations that have more resources. They say, well, what can I do? Almost everything that I talked about has strands that you can pull out for yourself. I think you have to think about where your community is right now. Do you even have a real community around your subject area? Will you tell me what subject area you're most interested in?
I'm working currently with an organization that deals with human trafficking.
Human trafficking. So this is something that's very popular topic. It's a very important topic that's being discussed a lot. So what I would want to do if I were in a nonprofit, I would want to make in that field is become a big digital authority on that topic. Turns out a lot of nonprofits, especially where they have a big personality founder, is that they have lots of influence in real life, but very little influence online. We have to not reduce the real life, but increase it online. And so how do I become one of the go-to authorities on this on human trafficking? Simple things you can do. You can share information about other organizations, other people, news articles, so that if I'm interested in the subject, I'm coming to you instead of following 50 other people, right? And you can. There are tools that can help you schedule tweets and things like that so that you don't have to do everything kind of from scratch every time. You can set it up in the morning and then tweet it out in the afternoon. You know, so that if you don't have time, I had a friend who built a very popular blog, and what he would do is on Sunday nights, He would sit down for 2 hours and write 7 posts. And he would have them come live Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. So we thought he was logging in every day, but he was doing it one time and then using it, having it come out later. So that's one simple thing. I would talk about, I'd think about tools like Blog Talk Radio, or is there a live video component? Is there, are there things that you've been doing already? The stories of your survivors, if they're willing to talk. Those are things that I would look at. But I think a combination of our own employee kind of intellectual, that font of knowledge, as well as the people we're helping, and making that connection to the press, to bloggers and influencers, and bringing them together as often as you can, I think is going to help. I hope that's a start to the answer. One of the people that I work with a lot in the nonprofit world is here, and I want to just show you here. So this is Stefan, who I mentioned earlier. He's S. Kaplan Photos, and I see also my friend Karen, who's my go-to person on nonprofits, is here as well, K.M. Siminski. So talk to her afterwards about what she's been doing with some big organizations around nonprofits. Yeah.
Other questions? There's a mic there if you come up, or...
Hi, Sree. Thanks for this.
Jerry
Weinstein. And I wanted to ask about design.
One second. Are you on Twitter, Jerry?
I am.
Okay. What's your handle?
At Tumler10. That's T-U-M-M-L-E-R, Yiddish for connector and troublemaker.
Oh, nice. So there you are. Nice.
There I am.
I like that. By the way, one tip, just what you did there. Every time you get a microphone, talk about your Twitter handle. And I like the way you spelled it and you made the connect. Now I won't forget, even though it's a word I've not heard. So that's really cool. I like that.
So in brief, a question about designing for web accessibility. Mm-hmm. I actually worked many places, but in fact, two museums, Museum of Sex and the Constitution Center in Philly. When we convened a meeting with stakeholders in the disabled community, they gave us an earful.
Yeah.
For both the physical experience and, of course, online being, you know, of limited sight and, you know, other things. So I'm wondering how we're looking at this world and creating it both the physical and your relationship with that and obviously with the social media.
Sure.
Thanks.
Thank you. And thanks for your work in helping museums. I just want to show you one of my colleagues and my former research assistant, Eliza Cooper, who we've worked on so many projects together, nonprofit projects, and she is completely blind. And she is fantastic on social, digital, everything else. If you're ever looking for someone to help you understand social, and especially from the angle of disabilities, you should talk to her. She's now a student at Columbia. She's at ElizaIn140. And you can say hi to her. What I've learned from her is exactly what you're asking about. Like, how do we make sure everything we do is accessible? One of the problems in a world where you're making these thumb stoppers, but there's no alt text, then people can't see it. So make sure that there's still printed text that can the blind can read through the various systems that they use. At the Met, we have a department that thinks about disability and access all the time. And we have touch tours of certain objects for blind people. Then we also think about the deaf and other kinds of disability as well. So we're on it, but the digital space makes it harder. If you go back on in 1996, I wrote a story about the problem with Flash and all the things that were happening on the web. Blind people were being locked out of it. So this is not new, and as the technology changes, and especially as we move to a visually centric world, it becomes harder, but that's where we can describe what we're doing. I think that becomes important.
Hi, I have a question.
What's your handle?
Well, my name's Pablo, it's Pablo CEV, but I'm not that active on Twitter. I'm figuring out how it works now.
Okay, good.
But my question is, do you have any advice on creating a fundraise campaign on social media?
Yeah, well, is that an assignment for your class?
I mean, I feel like
I want half that grade, by the way. I want half that grade. Fundraising campaign on social, you cannot start with the fundraising part, right? It's too late to start the fundraising if you don't have that community. That's why you want to constantly build a community, and then when you're ready, you hit them with what you want. So if you haven't done that, then if you have 3 months, it's still worth spending the first month building that community, because no one wants to hear you're going to charge money, you want this, you want to raise money. I just don't think that's how it works. So build that community, share information, and tell the stories. Why should they support you over every single great cause in the world? And the only way to do that is by having really good content and hiring freelance writers or, you know, other ways of which you're generating content that can then help you. Anyone have, like, a great idea that you wish more people did? Your chance to shout that out. Anybody have one thing that they want more people to know on this topic? Yeah.
Yeah, I encourage people to go to Kickstarter and Indiegogo and all these places. Sure. And recently I've been doing some research on crowdfunding. And check out these new things that are being created. Get information from other people's projects. Learn from them as well.
Yeah, and what's working and what's not working. Yeah. So you're not saying just start tomorrow with a Kickstarter campaign. You're saying understand what's working and what's not. And this is again Stefan, who's doing his thing. All right. Next. Thank you.
Hi, Sree. I'm Allison Fine. Fine.
Oh, hi. How are you?
Hi. I told Beth you gave her a shout out, and so she just gave you a shout out on Twitter. Great. So just so you know. I'm curious as to what you and your team are learning through the, what's the nicest word we can think of, Tom? What are we going to call it? Through the controversy about the Met logo, which I don't understand. It looked fine to me.
Wait, there's a controversy about the Met logo?
I know. It's new to you.
So now we're being recorded and we're, you know, normally when you go to a, yeah, exactly.
No, I'm not interested in the controversy. No, I'm interested in what you're learning.
I'll share that. But I'll also say that normally, you know, when you're in a class, you're able to say lots of things, but now we're being recorded. Yeah, yeah. This is off the record, but on Facebook, so it's fine. No, seriously, I think my take on, for those of you who haven't heard, you're lucky that you haven't had to hear about that. But the way I think about this is that one of my favorite sayings is, I'm all for progress. It's change I cannot stand. And every time an institution changes its logo, its branding, anything like that, people erupt in all kinds of anger. But there's a lesson. What I'm learning from that is how much people love the Met.
Yeah.
If they didn't care, they wouldn't make all this noise around it.
Right.
And all you saw was a logo. There's a whole branding and strategy and everything else around it, and that'll all be revealed on Monday. So this too shall pass is another thing. My message in for crisis management is things will pass, and that what we have to do in the nonprofit world is make sure that what we are doing has a reason that we can then explain and stand by what we are doing, right? I'm not an expert on branding, on logos, but we have some of the world's best people on that topic who we work with. So I can give you an example, the Uber logo. Has anybody seen, watched the controversy around that? If Lyft had changed its logo, I wouldn't care, right? Because I'm not a Lyft user. My wife would care, she's a Lyft user. But on Uber, like, I really care about finding that you really fast when I'm in a rush, right? So that's how I think about it. They've changed it. In 2 weeks, I wouldn't care because I'd be back on, I'd be using that. So that's what I think the lesson is, that as long as you did it for a reason and you can kind of stand by what you did and be proud of what you did and talk about it, I think there's not a problem there.
I think we have time for about two more.
Yeah. Sorry, can you just move over? By the way, Christiana, what a great thing she's doing for sharing and shooting all this video. So thank you for doing that. Okay.
Sree, how many people work in your department?
The museum, let's see. So the museum has about 2,200 employees, 600 security guards, and security staff overall. And our digital department has 70 people. Two of them doing social media. But I like to think that we have 2,200 people doing social media at the Met because they're all working together in one direction, pushing in one direction. Yes. Yay, Teachers College.
So my question follows up on what you just asked. How do you organize all of this content and get it out, right? It's easy to say there are two social media people, we have 70 digital, but how do you operationalize this on a day-to-day, week-to-week, month-to-month?
Yeah, so one of the things that we do, and let me see if I can show this to you here. One of the things we do is we work really hard on calendaring and having a plan for everything we're doing. So I posted just the other day, if I can find it easily here, on my Learn Social Media. Sorry, this is what happens when you post a lot. This was fun. This was the Beatles going to India for the first time, 1968. Let's see here. Sorry, just coming up. You'll see some of the people I've been talking about are here as well. By the way, there's a great free seminar on user experience webinar that you can join. In fact, by the UX head of Lyft, and he's going to talk about their new design and everything else. So if you find this in my feed, you can say it was just from yesterday. But I'm just trying to find one particular thing here. Let's go Learn Social Media. Sorry, just one second. Really, it's about planning and making sure that you are able to get a plan around what you need to do. So I posted this yesterday. This is from Rebecca, I'm not sure how to pronounce her last name, R-I-D-I-C-E, and she talks about the importance of checklists, planning calendars, goals, all of that. It's a beautiful one post that you can, your daily content strategy. Do you check in every day on Twitter? What is your workflow? All of that. So something like this is what I would want to do in my nonprofit.
Yeah, one last question.
Yeah. Yeah, hi. Actually, just as you said, the Met is the most famous museum in the world, and I just checked the Weibo account in Chinese, and you did a lot of like the content in the Year of the Monkey. So I'm really curious about what kind of the team structure for you, like how do you team just tailor like different content in different culture, and who is that people decide to what kind of the platform you want to post that message?
This is the question that we're always asking. What kind of content, at what time, to what communities do we have to do? The China question is really interesting for us. China has replaced all the other countries as the number one in-person traffic to the Met. So we have to now adjust our content to make sure we have a China presence. And we're on Weibo, and now we hear that we have to be on WeChat, and then we'll hear something else and something else. And then meanwhile, I have folks who ask, why aren't you posting in a lot of other languages? So it becomes very complicated. You have to figure out what makes sense for you in what you want to get done. And there's a friend of mine named Jim Rosenberg, who I encourage you to follow on Twitter. And he taught me, he works in nonprofits. He did World Bank, UNICEF. He was the kind of chief digital officer of these places, and he ran social at those places. And what he taught me, I've never forgotten. He said, your website is your home country. Your website is your home country, and your social media is your embassies. What that means is that depending on the social media, you'll have a big or small embassy, but everything there points back home to your website, and that's how you're able to capture and capture the interest that people have and continue the conversation. So what that means for us is we may have had a very small Chinese embassy, but now we have a big Chinese embassy. Some other country, we may be doing some exhibitions or some art, then we'll build a bigger embassy. But every embassy of U.S. embassy in the world has a picture of Obama and a Marine, right? They will have more Marines if it's a bigger embassy. Like, so that same way, thinking about that connection. Social media is your embassies, and your website is your home country. So as we wrap up here, I promised you my social media success formula. So let me just see if I can find that here. Sorry. I'm just going to pull that up. There's nothing worse than watching someone find his slides. And that's why I'm a big proponent of Bitly. You saw how quickly I found my slides. It was a completely different presentation, but very important to have a Bitly account. Who here has a Bitly account? bit.ly, so that you know when someone has opened your, you can use it for customization like this, but you can also use it to track how many people have opened your items. And by the way, if your boss ever sends you a Bitly account, just click on it multiple times, because you never know if he or she is tracking what you've said. So we're going to leave you with my social media success formula. And this is something that we have a lot of fun with, especially around Social Media Weekend. I, by the way, hope to see many of you there in June. But in this particular case, what we're doing is trying to give you a simple way to think about your content. So we're going to say these words together as if we're in a Baptist church on Sunday led by a Hindu priest. Okay, so it's kind of awkward and it's kind of weird, but that's fine. So we're going to say these words together. Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Hallelujah! All right, we're going to be loud and proud and everything else. Okay, here we go. We start with the word helpful and then we just go down the list. Okay, ready?
Helpful.
Can't hear you.
Useful. Timely.
Louder.
Formative.
Sing it, sister.
Relevant. Practical.
Say it, brother.
Actionable.
Take me home, mama.
Generous. Credible. Brief. Entertaining. Fun. Occasionally funny.
Amen. You've never been to a Baptist Hindu event before? That's how we do it. Not in a while. So this is, you'll say, well, this is a social media success formula. I'm a nonprofit. What's my success formula? Just remove the word social media. This is your organization. You are helpful, useful. Your content has to be not all of these things all the time, but each one should be at least some of these things. And I think if you put that together, you will have a lot of success. So just to recap how you can keep in touch with me, at Sree, or email me, sree@sree.net. We also have the Facebook group. How many of you joined the Facebook group? A few of you, right? That's good. And introduce yourselves in there once I connect you. Just find it by going to Sree's @Sree_S social media, and you'll find me there. And I want to just say to all of you who are interested in working in nonprofits, you could be doing many other things than working in nonprofits, and we thank you for doing that. And you could also be doing a lot more interesting things than being here on a Thursday night, and you're here, and I thank you for that. I did tell you that the scarcest resource is human attention. You've given me an hour plus of your attention, and that's a wonderful gift. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you very much, Sree. Thank you so much.